Hi, everybody, and welcome to Paul Lisnick Behind the Curtain. My opportunity, as you know, to step away from the worlds of politics and law that I cover on television to do something a little less stressful and a little more fun, which, of course, is the world of theater, which we get to do here on Behind the Curtain on WGNRadio.com. And joining me now, the cast, the director of one of the great shows of all time, Beautiful. It's going on now at the Marriott Lincolnshire Theater. And, you know, maybe you saw it on Broadway. Maybe you saw it when it came in on the national tour. Maybe you saw one of our guests in the show already. I don't know. We're going to find out a little bit about them and about this really unique kind of production of Beautiful that's going on at Marriott Lincolnshire. So welcome to all of you. And let me welcome our guests for being here. First of all, how do you talk about Beautiful, which is, of course, about the music of Carole King, without having the Carole King actor with us? And so Caitlin Davis joins us. You're no stranger to this role, Caitlin. I mean, it's not like this is the first time you played it. You've been on national tour. You've done it regionally. You live this role.
Yes, totally. Sorry. I love this role. It's very special to me, but it is very unique in this production, I would say. It feels totally fresh and new, and especially because I'm playing the piano, so that also adds a whole element to it.
Yeah, and actually here, the piano gets more costume changes than most of you, so it's sort of... Never seen that before, but it works very well. Yeah. And by the way, you yourself, this is very cool because I know you, I'm going to get to the rest of you in just a second, but I know you are a pianist, you are a songwriter, so you have to be relating to Carole King at a different level than maybe other actors might.
Oh my God, yeah. And like, I felt that way even just from seeing the show when I saw it on Broadway. I was like, I have to do this. It was like screaming from the inside out of me. I was like, I have to do this. This is so me. I relate with her so much every step of the way. It was not hard for me to like, understand why she does everything she does throughout the whole course of the show. So it makes it very easy as an actor when you relate this hard.
Right. What's tougher, this role or playing Christine in Phantom of the Opera, which you also did on national tour?
That's interesting. I think I'm so much older now that I think I would say Christine is harder because I was just not as prepared as a human being for that type of demanding situation. But I would say there's more to dig into with Carole. There's so many layers, right? There's comedy, there's drama, there's the fact that you're singing songs that your character and the characters around you know you're singing. So deciding how to act that, and there's a lot more to dig into. They're challenging in different ways, but. Yeah.
Well, unfortunate answer, because joining us now is Sir Andrew Lloyd Webber, who wanted to get more. And by the way, I want to show you, I forgot to have it with me at my desk, but I have a signed copy of Carole King's autobiography. So I too am really into her, really into this show and all of that. So I thought you'd let you know. Well, anyway, let me introduce somebody. Oh my God. Is your sign though, Andrew? I was just about to introduce you. Is your sign? Okay. Sorry. We're not hearing you.
No public library.
Oh, okay. So you're on the theft list. All right. And also I have a bingo card for the show Beautiful, and every square on it has a Mueller name in it, and you've got to be able to check off the Muellers before you can complete your bingo card. And so this time around it gave me the trifecta of Muellers appearing in this show, because playing Carole, your husband in the show, Jerry Goffin, is Andrew Mueller. Andrew, you know, look, this is about you. We're not talking about your sisters, but you got to at least give me the due of acknowledging you have some sisters who are also a little familiar with this show.
I do. Yes. I've known this show since its inception, once it was actually finally in performances. I love the show. I've always been a big fan. And it has been a challenge, but it's one that I had a little bit of lead up to think about. So
yeah. And by the way, does it, you know, here's Caitlin playing the same role that both your sisters, Jessie and Abby, have played. I've interviewed Abby when she came in through the national tour. I saw Jessie on Broadway. But I'm not about to ask you who's better or anything like that. That would, you know, we're not going to do that. But I will tell you, but let me ask you, as somebody who's playing this, do you see, like, are they all very similar Carole Kings to you? Is like, if Carole King was in the audience, would she say every one of them is me? Or do you see some distinctions and differences, which is going to lead into our introduction of the director in just a moment, because that part of the answer, but what was your sense of it?
I mean, if Carole King was in the audience, I would have some other questions to ask her. Obviously, every performer is going to bring something different to the role, and it's an interesting line when you're playing a real person, because you're still playing the show's character of that person. And in that way, one of the ways I described seeing both my sisters do the same role was that it was like, it was very clearly themselves and it was very clearly Carole. And I imagined it as like them putting a Carole King effects, like guitar effects pedal on their voice and then going into the role. I'm not as familiar with Caitlin's non-Carole King voice at this point. I have many more data points of just her Carole King voice, but everyone's different. Everyone's great. I'm a big fan of all three of these fantastic performers. And no, I'm not going to say anything against any of them.
Nor should you.
Judge them.
By the way, have your sisters seen the show and do they think it was weird that their brother was playing their husband?
They have not seen the show yet. Okay. I don't know if I'm supposed to talk about when or if they see the show. But
you don't have to tell us
when.
You can give us an if. You know, if is good.
Yeah. No one has made any comments about it weird that I'm playing the husband of a character that my sisters made famous. So
then I was just the first.
And hasn't been on my mind at all.
This is not, by the way, your Marriott debut. You were in Man of La Mancha. And of course, you and I chatted when you were at Porchlight playing Ernest Shackleton Loves Me. And this is rare for you. It's a beardless role. So that's something you don't seem to do very often. But there you go.
It's true. It is a beardless role. And that's really been the most difficult facet of this performance for me is the shaving.
Just to chime in, you do wear a beard.
I do wear a beard. That's true. It is a costume beard.
I'm just having my own moment because of when we talked last time and when I first saw you and all of that. So I was just going through that experience, but you are right. And chiming in as a director should to correct comments made by actors and reviewer critic types and all of that. Jessica Fish, who directed the show. And Jessica, first of all, you're a Jeff Award winner. And if people, they should know your work because I can't think of a theater you haven't worked. Steppenwolf and Goodman and which, by the way, I've interviewed the cast of POTUS. That's already up, so you might check that interview out. That was great fun. And Writers Theater, and just on and on with the work you've done. Public Theater. Oh, and also, after I'm done talking to you guys, I'm talking to Gail Papp. And Joseph Papp's widow. So we're going to talk about the Public Theater and all that. Yeah, so that should be really interesting. But anyway, incredible experience that you have. But I want to talk about something that you said about Carole King and about your experience with this, because I think that probably informs how you chose to direct this show. And you wrote in the program about how when you were a kid, you were in the car. And why don't you tell that story? But Carole King and her cat kind of play, I assume it was her cat. Or she stole somebody's cat. I don't know. But she played a role in your world of Carole King and how you see her.
Yeah. I mean, I feel like people are definitely influenced by the music that's sort of just like played around you at a very young age. And my parents were huge Carole King, Joni Mitchell, James Taylor. You know, these are the people that like sort of they played throughout our lives. And we did a lot of road trips I grew up in New Jersey. We did a lot of road trips up to my family in Boston. And we had like 5 tapes in the car. And so one of them was Tapestry. And we just like played, you know, the drive is 4 hours. You can get through 4 of the tapes. I mean, that's like, that's my experience of driving up, you know, up on the, you know, the up north. And so
have the ability to turn the cassette around automatically?
No, this was the 80s. It certainly did not. And it was like a small sedan. And I was like fighting in the backseat with my sister most of the ride. And so we just stared at that, like that iconic cover, which ironically, I'll just show and tell like Andrew.
I have sign?
Right here. No, actually, but this is my parents came to opening, which they have never really done. They don't live here. And so it's been great. They was really like moving and lovely to have them. My mom and dad showed up with their copy of Tapestry and they framed it for me and like put a note on the back. And I was very beautiful and very emotional.
How neat. Wait, they put really, the note on the back, which you can't see because it's in a frame.
No, they wrote it on the back.
Oh, okay. Like, okay.
Yeah. No. But they were like, this has all the liner notes and the actual record in it.
I love it.
It was really sweet. So this, you know, like, I just feel like there wasn't a time in my life where I didn't know this music. It's just in my sort of DNA. And so when the opportunity, you know, arose to direct the play, I sort of jumped at it. It felt like an opportunity to sort of make a love letter to them. And also, I just, it's such a fun, beautiful show. Oh, Andrew, I did it. It's such a fun, beautiful show.
And good use of the title, beautiful right there. Well, there was something else that you wrote when I kind of began to prepare for this interview, and it made me go back to look at my for me, Tapestry. I did have an LP growing up, but you know, things changed. So now it's on CD for me, and probably on a Betamax somewhere, because I could probably do that too. But anyway, but here's the thing. You said something that really caught my attention. I went and looked at the album cover again, but everybody else needs to listen because you're going to chime in on this. You said that Carole King, and I'm quoting a little bit. Yeah, there we go. By the way, what was the cat's name, Jessica?
His name is Telemachus.
Okay.
Which, as like a Greek nerd, as a Greek, you know, history nerd, I love that as well.
She let Jerry name the cat.
Is that right? I didn't know that.
I heard somewhere she let Jerry name the cat because they were amicably co-parenting that entire time. The show takes liberties for dramatic effect, but yeah.
Okay, so there's no cat in that. You could have had a stuffed cat, something that just sits on the table or something. And
we have a fake baby instead.
And everybody keeps asking me where James Taylor is. And I was like, I cannot answer that. I'm sorry. There's no James Taylor.
He's kind of Nick. He's a little bit the character Nick, sort of.
Yeah, he's a little Nick.
Yes.
Yeah.
It feels like he was like hard pass.
I love it. Well, here's the thing. What you said about Carole King that made me go look at it, and I'm just paraphrasing a little bit, but you said she was a reluctant star despite her apparent unwillingness to center herself in the frame. And of course, that's kind of a double meaning there, because I think you were referring to the album cover, but at the same time, that really is a comment about her life. So I want you, Jessica, first to talk about that had to inform the way in which you approach and began to direct the show. And then I want Caitlin and Andrew to chime in, because that to me sounded like a pretty major point of the vision for how Carole is going to appear in this edition.
Yeah. I mean, you got it, Paul. Yeah, good. No, absolutely. I think that, you know, so often these sort of like this, like jukebox musical genre, which I really am reluctant to put Beautiful into, because I really love the book of Beautiful. I think that so often those are the stories of someone like striving for fame, and like the story of like how they fought tooth and nail, or like overcame all these obstacles to achieve the thing they've always wanted. And it's sort of like a hero's journey in that way. And I feel like actually the thing that's so remarkable about Beautiful to me is that, yes, Carole was this like 16-year-old prodigy who knew that she wanted to sell her music and write these songs. But actually, like, the last thing she wanted was to be the front and center face of her music. And it just literally got to the point where it was, you know, this Tapestry album just like was so much of her story that she could not be the star anymore. And, you know, I think we see that in the show, it's beautifully sort of demonstrated, but also it makes for this really interesting, dramatically interesting character who has to overcome a different set of obstacles, insecurity and doubt and her own preconceived notions about what a star is, to become the Carole King that we all know and love. But it did not sit naturally on her. And I think that's what makes it such a dynamic performance that Kate gives.
And that's a beautiful leeway or a segue here into Caitlin. By the way, Caitlin, you talked about this role some with my lifelong friend, Steve Dale on WGN Radio. Any interesting factoid you can share with us about Steve that you might have learned?
I believe he mentioned he was older than you.
Thank you very much. Okay, now we'll go. Trust me, Steve will watch this and I'm going to get a text. And you might even get a text. But let me ask you this. So now we just heard Jessica's vision. You've heard it before, but you played this role also on a national tour. And, and that means you had a different director. So how does this Carole King production performance differ from other ways, if at all, other ways you have presented Carole to audiences?
It actually really does. And I think it's interesting, not at all to I love the original production very much. Of course, that's the one that I saw and I'm very grateful that I got to do it. I think having a female lens on a female character has been very enlightening. I think there's a level of Carole's anger that was not as explored in the original version of the show. And I think it feels like her anger when she finally confronts Jerry at, you know, Marilyn's door, I think her anger can sort of feel like it comes out of nowhere, but it really doesn't come out of nowhere. There is a slow burn throughout the show leading up to that moment, but they're definitely like, I had it described to me in a completely different way. Like something Jess said was, there's this line that I say, this may be too detailed of a response, but there's this line that I say, look, get your things and come home. And Jess said, almost like he's a child. And I was like, yeah, that is exactly how that feels. But originally it was described to me more as, this is not your typical confrontation scene. You know, there's a lot of nuance here, and it's not so much anger, and she's not even going to leave him when she comes to the door and all this stuff. And having a female lens on it really is this, I don't want to have to parent my husband. And that I think is such a common female experience. And it's not even just her husband. There's a lot of, sorry, Andrew, there's a lot of things that happen where you're like, I don't want to have to be the mature one in this situation. Don't make me do this. Is the level of nuance of the situation, but it is also like this righteous female anger that I think comes through very clearly when there is a female lens on it. And that has been something very, very formative and different to this production.
By the way, did Jessica, I'm gonna ask Caitlin the question. Kate, did Jessica ever say to you, how did you play this before? What were you told before? Or we didn't go there at all?
No, but she did say, are you sure you would like to change it? Are you like set in what you do, or are you interested in creating something new? So I did come in, and I came in knowing like, oh, this is going to be different. And I think what works really well too is that because we're in the round, and because it had to be redesigned so thoughtfully for the round, it was pretty easy for me to not feel like I was doing the same thing with a different hat. Like it felt very new from the jump of this production.
Yeah. And we're going to get to that. I want to talk about being in the round. That's so critical to this. And by the way, we don't know if or when any of the Mueller sisters are coming, Kate, but if they are, do you care?
Yes. Please don't tell me. Tell me after and then I'll cry.
Okay. I wanted to find out because I didn't want, you know, like Andrew backstage to just go, they're out there tonight together, front row.
Andrew is incredibly thoughtful and already asked me how I would feel about that, because he is a very thoughtful and wonderful scene partner. So he was in the know.
But I'll bet his mom didn't.
I also attempted to couch it in like, you don't have to feel any sort of way about this, but in case you did.
Yes.
I love it. And by the way, your mom, who is responsible for all of you, and I've met her at Ernest Shackleton, has she been there yet?
Oh, my mom has seen it like 4 times.
That's what I thought. Okay. So, Andrew, let me talk to you, because your character, Jerry, I have a tough time with him. I'm not going to say he's a love-hate relationship with the audience. He's kind of a like-dislike relationship with the audience, because there is a lot to like about him and the way you play him. But at the same time, he's kind of crappy to Carole, and we love Carole. So talk to me about how you view this role and the challenge of, because you got to keep I think, Jessica could correct me, but I think you still have to keep the audience with you. I don't think this works if we end up at the end just not liking Jerry. We have to like him.
Yes, that is sort of the crux of the endeavor, it would seem. It's delicate. It's delicate business. It's fascinating, again, going back to the idea of playing the play's version of a real person, because I did go back and I read Carole King's book, and that talks a bit more about Jerry as a person. To my knowledge, I was not able to find a biography of him specifically. And there are things about him that aren't in the play. There are things about mental illness that the play doesn't necessarily go into, you know, medical detail about. So there's a balance there of also trying to not play something that's not in the script. And I'm rambling now. Jumping back to topic.
I didn't know that because while I have Carole's signed book, I didn't read it. So, I'm sort of curious yet. What you're saying is really interesting. So if there were true mental health issues with him, how did you work that out with Jessica? Is it sort of like, look, here's this character who is going to be secondary to Carole because she's the focus, but yet he's got this deeper and maybe darker side. Does the audience need to connect with that? What's your view? And I want to hear Jessica's view on that.
Well, I mean, we had certainly talked about the fact that we knew that also it was the 1960s understanding of mental illness and those sorts of things. So the terminology changed several times, and what he actually had is kind of up in the air. But that was kind of the the background, the foundation. And it's like, okay, so we all know this, but let's move forward with what's in the script and what we can play and what the script is allowed to say without editorializing externally. Jess, did I the general?
No, I mean, Andrew can't be unlikable. I mean, he is an incredible actor, but he is a deeply likable person. I mean, it's, you know, when he walked in the room to audition for this role, he showed me something nobody else had shown me. That period, end of sentence.
To ask what that was, but
that's right. It was the fact that he was tapping into what it meant to be a tortured artist, right? To just believe in what you do with your full essence and your full body, and yet that it leads you astray, that it causes you to make bad decisions, that it puts your family and your life in jeopardy. You know, and that, to me, that's very relatable. And I never disliked Jerry. I mean, we spent a lot of time in the sort of like the penultimate scene of this play. And I think there is a world in which you could leave that scene hating Jerry. Kate alluded to people hissing at him during a tour performance. And and I never feel like that.
They hissed at him in the curtain call?
No, in the scene when they're in the dressing room at Carnegie Hall.
Okay.
And he, you know, they get to reconnect after many years. And I find that scene, the way that these two people play it, to be incredibly moving and complicated. There was a moment in rehearsal where Kate wanted to get up. This is not how I direct, but in this moment, this is how I directed. Kate wanted, do you remember this, Kate? Like, you wanted to go over to him. And I said, sit down. You don't know him, Matt. Sit down. You don't go to him. You don't know him, Matt. And I think that, like,
it's hard.
But sounds like a tough director, if you ask me, by the way. I said, sit down.
No.
That's exactly how I direct. I just sit down, do this. No,
that's
but
blocking. That's just blocking.
That's blocking. Sit. No, but there's this balance and nuance that these two incredible actors are bringing to this role to make them complicated. They are, you know, they are complex human beings. And yes, they are based on real people, but we play them like they are dramatic characters who want things and who make mistakes. And I think that, like, it really, we found a balance that is very, I find very moving. And they're both complicated people.
And I think you're right. I mean, the, at least in this case, Andrew, you are. You're a nice guy. You're a good looking guy, whatever. And I think it's hard to dislike you within there, but you have your moments. So let's talk about doing this in the round, because there aren't a lot of theaters in the round in Chicago. I mean, you know, except when Hamilton is playing, or when Steppenwolf's New Theater, or when Goodman in the Owen decides to do something. But here, this is by definition the way it's always going to be at Marriott. And Jessica, you're actually the first director from a Marriott production I've talked to. I've always talked to cast members. And so the challenge, the challenge of directing in the round, because, for example, Damn Yankees, right, chatted with Sean Fortunato and Andrew Alstead and all of them. But here's the thing, they have lockers and all this kind of stuff, which I found can be distracting. You have to have them, and they did what they could, and they didn't have backs to them. But you always have to be conscious of getting that 360 non-blocked view, I think.
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, first of all, I never saw, unlike these two people, I never saw Beautiful. I was out of New York by the time it was on Broadway. And when the tour came through, I was giving birth. So I didn't get to see it. So I had no preconceived notions about, like, what it should be, which is a gift, I think, in a lot of ways. You know, I am the kind of director where I really work from, like, the world into character. I really don't even know who the people are until I cast it, and then I'm like, oh, this is who they are. But, like, once the world is built, that's when I know I can do the play. And so,
by the way, I'm sorry to interrupt you, but that's true whether you're casting fictional people versus real people,
period. Yeah, but I don't, like, that's my favorite thing, right? Like, the actors bring a whole component of the character that I until they walk into the room and audition for me, I don't even really know who they are. And then it presents itself, and I'm like, that's it. So I'm really like a world in person. And to do that requires putting together an incredible design team. And we have truly the most incredible design team. I got to work with a couple of artists who I've worked with many times over, Andrew Boyce on the scenic, and Tony Churchill with the video. And from the very get-go, we talked about creating an environment that embrace the fact that this is a memory play, that the space wants to feel very transformative. And this, I do this all the time because we really approach the play like it was always having this like sort of tornado of movement. And it's very circular. It's very, there's a lot of sense of movement, both in the beautiful set that we have, the turntable that is the stack of records, and also just like the way the video engulfs the space. And so I let that lead the way that we approached doing the show. And I just wanted to have this sense of a memory play, of it sort of swirling around Carole all the time. And that's how we begin and end the play. And the grand piano, which that's you were right. alluding to.
Yes. Well, sometimes it's a grand, it's a very versatile performer. It can be an upright too, what it wants to be.
That's right. Magic piano.
Yeah. And by the way, Kate, I mean, you've said this before, but you are playing. I mean, that's right. You are playing that piano.
Yeah.
It was sort of like when Sean Hayes did Goodnight Oscar and Sean was actually playing. And a lot of people like, was he really playing? Is it a trick? Whatever. You are playing.
Yes, I am really playing, which feels great. I was terrified. And I thought whoever this Jess Fish person was crazy, because I was like, what? How is that even going to be possible? Like, I knew, I was like, I have to be changing clothes when some of that music is happening. Like, how is that ever going to happen? But we had enough time for me to really prepare. So it's really cool.
And let me get you, and we'll ask Andrew, your reactions to, again, appearing in the round, because you know that wherever you're looking, there's people behind you. So how are you aware of it? And by the way, in the song moments, and certainly your concert moments in the end, there's no better way to do it than in the round, in my view. It's perfect. But your thoughts?
I really think it's working well. I've had a lot of audience members come up to me and say they forgot a lot of the meat of the scenes from seeing it in proscenium. And I think the fact that they are so close up to us, it really, like, they are engulfed in not only the music, but the story as well. And I think they can really see a lot of the reason maybe they don't hate Andrew so much. Well, Andrew's also very likable, but I think they can
really-
It's
not about Jerry, it's about you, Andrew, just so you understand what she's saying.
I think they can really see how much he's struggling in each and every time that he is, you know, breaking down or struggling through something. So I think there's a lot of empathy they feel for the characters because they're basically in our laps in the scene. So it really, like, takes it home.
Yeah. By the way, I want to just do a quick shout out to Janet Ulrich Brooks, who's a friend and was going to join us. She was a little under the weather today, so not with us for that reason.
But the queen.
She plays your mom, and I mean, as a mom, I didn't see you with other moms, but I love the way she plays this role, Kate.
She is excellent. She is so excellent. And I think the way she plays the emotional scene that launches Carole into like the tapestry era is so unbelievably perfect. She really gets me, like, emotionally, I mean, like, and I just feel genuinely empowered to go off and write an album after Janet sends me off. Like, she is wonderful.
She's great. She's a Chicago treasure. And Andrew, so you as well, again, you're not really ever playing with an audience perspective in terms of you're not performing like Carole is, but you have to be aware of in the round, and we probably get more because of your ups and downs in the role of Jerry. So how are you addressing this audience? And are you ever getting looks back from the audience in those moments when they're not happy with you? And does that bother you if you get them?
Oh, I don't just get looks. Well, one thing about being in the round is that there are four entrances and exits that you have to leave to go. You go right past audience members every time you enter and exit the stage. And there have been people who have whispered very mean things at me.
Really?
As I leave the stage, yes, multiple times.
Can you share? I know it's just kind of fun, but what do they? I mean, assuming it's not swearing, but what do they say? Like, you're mean?
Oh no, it's swearing. No, it's swearing. The one that isn't swearing was recently someone, a woman whispered "loser" at me, and then
that was
she
me.
And
that
her
was
friends
when I was there. I was sitting
at
right
each other, giggling. Yeah. So I'm sensing that it's a very cathartic experience for the audience. Being in the round, it really is very, very intimate. And it's one of those things. It's been well blocked and well choreographed, so that if you are looking at someone's back in one moment of a scene, either by the next moment or by the next scene, you will get a different perspective and all these things, or just come back and see the show a couple times and get different seats.
Isn't it right?
But
and
yes,
watch you
it
move
is very,
furniture.
Yes, it is. It is very, there's a vulnerability to it that a proscenium doesn't necessarily have innately. But yes, mostly I'm just glad I got the opportunity to mention that the audience has been saying really mean things to me.
Wow. And I would, and by the way, so now I have to ask you, what is your, so when somebody yells out loser or something or mean things, even worse than that, do you just go, oh, you're talking to Jerry? Does it go in one ear and out the other? Or do you like pause for a moment and go, ouch?
No, he texts me. He texts me.
I did text Jess, which mostly to say, I think it's working.
Okay.
I've been endeavoring to compartmentalize enough so that this doesn't play into deep-seated fears that every room I walk into, everyone groans audibly. but yeah, I think that just means that the character and the effect he's having on Carole is that effect is also being had on the audience, and they are sometimes almost violently reacting to the choices, the poor choices that he's making.
Yeah. You know, it's funny. It means you're doing the role right because people are reacting. There's an actor here in Chicago you might know named Raymond Fox, and he was in a show directed by David Schwimmer, and he plays this child predator kind of role. And every time I see Raymond after that, and it's been years, I'm like, I can't talk to you. I can't. There's just you. That was so freaking me out in that role that everything, he could play Santa Claus and it wouldn't matter to me anymore. He was just that good. But just let me ask you, were you just surprised? Well, no, you weren't surprised because he's texting you. But, you know, are you saying, good, we're getting those reactions? Or are you like, oh, Andrew,
no,
hang
I'm
in there,
saying,
you'll be okay.
Oh my God, are you okay? No, but
loser.
No, I mean, it's, you can't sit in the audience and not clock that this means a lot to people. That like these songs, I mean, my favorite part is sitting in the audience and a song starts, it's often Kate like hitting the first two notes on the piano or something, and they all go, oh. I mean, one of the moments that we get that all the time is, you know, when the Righteous Brother, we hear the first couple of chords of You've Lost That Love and Feeling, people go like, oh my God, you know, it's the visceral reactions people have to this music, and apparently these people, is just incredible. I mean, that's, what more could we wish for than to have people feel literally moved to react in any kind of way? I mean, that's why we do our jobs, I think. I mean, the show, obviously, we've been talking about Carole and Jerry and how pivotal that grounding that relationship is. But the show is really a showcase for so many of the sort of like songs and artists that people sort of like hold dear to
Barry and Cynthia. I mean,
I mean, the Righteous Brothers, you know, the Shirelles, the Drifters. I mean, I didn't realize until opening night, like Up on the Roof was apparently like one of my parents' songs. And then suddenly like my dad's like crying during Up on the Roof. I was like, Dad, what's wrong with you? You know, it's like these songs mean a lot to people. And and we have this incredible ensemble of actors portraying all of these like iconic performers and, you know, doing it down ramps and in heels and on spinning records. I mean, it's a virtuosic performance is happening.
Yeah, it's so true. I love this cast. And of course, a lot of them are familiar Chicago faces, so it's a thrill for me when I get to see them up there and doing that. And Kate, I went to a matinee because here's good news. I was having trouble getting tickets for an evening performance because it was selling out so much. So I went to a matinee where I was proud to be one of the youngest people in the audience. But I want to ask you, one of the things you can kind of hear people like, they didn't sing I Feel the Earth Move. What I'm waiting for. And of course, why am I ruining anything if I say how that comes up? I'll let you talk about it, Kate. Nah, the heck with it. Okay.
No, it's fine.
So that is something that the audience actually gets to join you on. It's like one of the best, and there we are doing it. Is that, by the way, Kate, I think the answer is yes, but is that in the script? I mean, so when they wrote the show, they're like, we're going to get the audience involved in this, or was that a Marianne?
We definitely like encourage it loosely across the board, but I outright say sing along. I apparently
Yes, you do.
I didn't warn Jess that I was doing that. I guess I gave everybody an ulcer on the first preview.
Did Jess yell out, sit down?
No. Yeah, imagine during the preview, sit back down, Kate.
I'll decide who sings along.
No, it is great. I love the enthusiasm that I get, and I really try to pick out in each section like my most enthusiastic audience members and like try to like point at them and like groove along. I really like, I also love when there's enthusiasm and the audience does not know what verse it is and they're like locked eyes with me and we are saying different words, and I love it. I think it's great, and it's really a fun time.
Well, my audience knew. They all lived those songs.
Yeah.
Beautiful is playing at the Marriott Theater, and you can get tickets at marriotttheater.com, spelled T-R-E, the British way of doing it, which, by the way, I don't take intermissions. I take intervals. You guys are absolutely phenomenal in it. It's playing through New Year's Eve, correct?
We just extended. We're actually playing through January 7th.
Glad to hear it. So then Andrew can drink with the audience on New Year's Eve. This is a good thing that his character Jerry will want to do that. Before we lose our time limit here, thank you all. Break legs every night. Thank you for your time with me. This was great fun and great perspective to get the director. I wish you all happy holidays and a happy new year. And you guys are beautiful.
Thank you, Paul.
He said the thing. Thank you, Paul.
Thanks.